the world make over. Mashiach will come take over. You ain't gotta be me or see what I see. All you gotta do is take a look forward. Lift up your eye to the sky. Spread out your hands. Say thank you, smile. Get them up, put them up, leave them up. Ha ha. Yep, yep. Pump up the volume every day. Stand in place. Heart racing, no words to say. Pressure building, trying to hold my face. Mind drifting like not today. Wake up from everything. Break out your shell and scream. Ha Shim, you're the king. Ha Shim, you're the king.
Hashem Elech, Hashem Malach, Hashem Imloch Leolam Vaed. Hashem Elech, Hashem Malach, Hashem Imloch. Hashem Elech, Hashem Malach, Hashem Imloch Leolam Vaed. Hashem Elech, Hashem Malach, Hashem Imloch Leolam Vaed.
Thank you. Yeah. lado, é.
Short, Divrei Bracha to Yaakov, and then afterwards Yaakov will speak, and that will be it for the speeches. And if everybody knows Yaakov, I promise you it's going to be brief. Hopefully he'll speak slowly so that so everybody can understand. And then we can all go back to having a dance and eating. So thank you all for coming to the Bar Mitzvah celebration of our dear son Yaakov. As you know, this week, Baruch Hashem, has been a whirlwind of activity for our family. Baruch Hashem, we were able to welcome Rebecca into our family, and we are thrilled that Ariel has found his Basher. But everyone should know that while this was all going on, with Ariel and Rebecca, Yaakov was full of simcha for Ariel. And not for one moment did he feel that the spotlight is being taken away from him. It is truly a testimony to the warm and sharing heart which Yaakov has. So tonight, we're going to make it all about Yaakov. It's his party and his celebration of this milestone in his life. Mommy and I are very proud of you, your accomplishment, and your menschlichkeit. We are sure that you will continue to make us proud. I have a thought to share with Yaakov, and I will talk to him, and I will allow everyone else to listen to me. Yaakov, in this week's parasha, which you read so beautifully, the Torah tells us of the tefillah of Avraham Avinu, when he's davening to Hashem to save Sodom from destruction. As you read, the Torah records that Avraham is sort of grasping at straws. First he asks Hashem to save Sodom if there are 50 tzaddikim in the city. When Hashem said that there aren't 50, he asked for 45, and then 40, then 30, then 20, then 10. We find that Avraham Avinu was constantly asking Hashem in tefillah, even though he was being denied his request to save Sodom. So my question is, why did Avraham feel that he had the right to keep on asking Hashem for something time and time again? Keep on changing the deal and still persisting at trying to save Sodom. Yaakov, I think we can answer this question with the pasuk which you say every single day, three times a day. In Ashrei, you say, Karav Hashem l'chol karav, l'chol asher yikru be'emes. The key word in that pasuk is emes, truth, and sincerity. For, you see, Hashem has given mankind the gift of tefillah. And Hashem promises us that he will be close to all of those who cry out to him in tefillah, but with one caveat, with one condition, that the tefillah has to be be'emes, truth, sincerity. When Avraham was constantly asking Hashem to save Sodom, there was no doubt that Avraham, who was the epitome of an ish chesed, was asking with all sincerity to save Sodom. He was asking with emes, with truth. That enabled him to keep on asking. Yaakov, I have watched you the past few months trying to improve your davening, which did not come easy to you. You sincerely have asked me how you can try and say certain parts of tefillah while not yet ready to conquer others. I sense in your asking a sense of yearning and truth and sincerity and really trying to daven to Hashem for what you want to ask for. So my message to you, Yaakov, is to keep davening for what you desire. Keep asking Hashem with emes. Keep asking Hashem with truth and sincerity. Like the Chafetz Chaim says, you're supposed to daven like a child, with sincerity, truth, innocence. I'm sure that if you continue on this road, Hashem will answer all your tefillos. I know that Mommy and I daven every day for you and all of our children, that Hashem should grant you all of your desires, L'tov. May you continue to grow up being the loving, caring, and warm individual which you are, and continue to give Mommy and me much nachas for the future. We love you. And now I would like to ask Yaakov to please come up and say a few words.
Hi everybody, thank you for coming to my bar mitzvah. I'll try to make it short because if I have anything like my brothers, I'll probably read this really fast and you won't hear a word I say anyways. But as you all know, I'm nothing at all like my brothers, so you just might want to pay attention. So you all know that reading is not really my thing, and I didn't want to get here and read for 10 minutes about some popo gemara, which by the way is also not my thing. Yet. I'm working on it. So I want to talk about something that has been on my mind recently, and that is davening. Okay, so that's also not my thing. But since I'm now bar mitzvah, I really have to work on getting good at it. And like my parents always say, I can do whatever I set my mind to. So I'm really trying. But my question is, if davening in Hebrew is harder, and I'm able to daven in another language? So I asked my parents this question, and of course my father came up with a whole list of sources that say you can, and some of them when and where you can. My mother, who's a spiritual one in the family, had a field day with it. It sort of had to meld the two together, and this is what we came up with. 13 years ago, when I was born, there was no doubt about what my parents would name me. My father got speaking from Rabbi Yaakov Yitzchak Rudiman, and he was also the Masada Kedushin at my parents' wedding. My father always wanted to name his son after Rabbi Rudiman. Well, my mother got her most with other, and when I came to meet, it really was my father's turn. So I have the privilege to not only be named after such a great tzaddik, but also be named after two of the three Avos. Well, as you all know, the Avos were Masadik, Shachar, Mincha, and Maariv, so according to my mother, this means I will have extra help from Hashem in my davening. The Mishnah in Sotah says very clearly that tefillah can be said in any language, the Gemara ever qualifies statement, and it makes a difference if one davening alone or with a minion. And whether he is davening in Aramaic or any other language, the Mishnah of Ruach writes that it is mitzvah to daven in Hebrew, which is Lashon HaKodesh. But he brings the Magen Avraham, who says that it's better to daven in a language you would understand. Of course, I have to learn how to daven all its fields and shul, but I can always talk to Hashem whenever I want in any language I want. I prefer English. The Gemara Brachos Lamed Beis Amud Beis, the Rebbe Chanina says the name of Rebbe Chanina, if a person doesn't get answered, he should go back and pray to Hashem again. A person can keep davening for things just like Avraham Yitzchak did in order to finally have children. Also, in my Bar Mitzvah Parsha Vayera, Avraham Avinu kept begging Hashem for Saint Sodom. We learn from this that a person can keep asking Hashem over and over again for things he wants. Avraham did not take no for an answer, which is very reminiscent of me. In fact, my grandparents, parents, siblings, or baby teachers can all vouch for the fact that I very rarely take no for an answer. I can be extremely persistent, so now my job is to channel all that persistence into learning how to daven. And ask Hashem over and over again to help me become a true Ben Torah. Which brings me to the part of my speech where I must thank all my Rebbeim and Yeshiva Darkei Torah who worked tirelessly and lovingly throughout my years in school to teach me to read and learn how to love Torah. Each and every one of them gave me special attention and went out of their way to help me learn, and I feel like I have a special relationship with all of them. I would especially like to thank Rebbe Howitzal, who taught me how to enjoy learning Gemara and have proper minos and respect for Rebbe. I want to thank my siblings for what they did for the past 13 years. I'm not going to tell you my whole life story. I'll try to make it brief. I would like to thank Yonatan for being there for me. Like, literally, he's wherever I am. He also has a huge impact on my davening. Doesn't even know it, but whenever I get excited, like my first time I did the whole Shabbos davening, Yonatan goes over me and says, "What's wrong with you? Are you Jewish? Do you say Kaveh?" You're making a wonderful brother sometimes. I also like to thank Atara. She basically made Bar Mitzvah. By the way, just in case you wanted to make your Bar Mitzvah, her number is 516-650-1581. Just kidding. She's an amazing sister, and she always makes a good mood, especially when Rainbow teacher says, "Want to go for pizza, Vasi Shabbos?" and then have a whole DMC about losing weight. Atara, you're an awesome sister, and thank you for making my invitations in one montage. Arya, here we go. I can't really fit what I have to say about you on this paper. You always give me the extra push to do things. You always know what's up with me, which is annoying because when I have a surprise for him, he somehow gets it out of me. I'm getting a little off topic, but thank you for everything. No, really, like all the stuff that I took from your room. Breaking news. Ariel, I want you to wish a special milestone. We all keep hearing about how perfect Rebecca is. All I know is that she makes me annoyingly happy. Rebecca, welcome to the family. I would also like to thank Benjamin and Gabby. Some people might call my brother Big Ben, and he really is big. Always good to have someone who never trusts me with anything, so then I try to work on myself more. Sometimes you surprise me and you're really nice to me. Thank you for introducing me to the finer things in life. Brian Bistro and Pleated Ties. Malki and Moshe, thank you so much for stepping all the way and making the trip in with all the kids from my Bar Mitzvah. Malki, although I don't really remember growing up with you, or Lisa in the house, and Moshe is very special to me, and I can't wait to go to Israel so I can spend more time with you. Hang in there, guys. My speech is almost over. Lisa and Aaron. Lisa, sometimes you're a second mother to me, but I liked it better when you thought I was cute. Aaron, you're a great overwatch to me. Oh, you taught me how to drink beer, and you're only the one in the family who eats more than me. Seriously, you are such a nice guy, and I'm lucky to have you and Moshe as our brother-in-laws. I would also like to thank a special thank you to my cousin Benjamin. He's the only one younger than me besides my nieces and nephews, but not by much. You are such a great friend, and it's fun when I try to beat you in NHL 15. I really love hanging out with you. being grandpa. I love it when you come and buy the coolest games. Your potato Google is the best. Thank you for an awesome Sidur. Okay. Bubby and Zadie, you are the coolest grandparents. Thank you for that. You did for my birthday. Give Sundays at the pool, Payback in Florida. The list is endless. Most of all, thank you for my tefillin. I will think of you every time I put them on. And then finally, my parents remember what I said about Ariel, how I can't fit ending of age. Well, I can't express what you have done for me in this whole entire world. You helped me with davening, like you heard for the past 10 minutes, but my parents were not satisfied with, okay, we'll have to practice landing by himself or something like that. It went to the point where I heard my mom playing in the Little Landing soundtrack in her car. I think you and Dad teaching me how to live life and how we stay in our family, be normal. So I thank my parents so much for everything, especially my bar mitzvah. Trust me, and you faint if you saw the bill. You guys did so much for me. I love you, and I thank Hashem for giving me the best parents, your family, and friends in the entire world. Thank you, and have a good time. Everybody. Shout out to Abel.
בלב יש מגמה להתקרב להכיר בורא עולם אל חי וקיים מה ייאוש אותך שובר כל כך קשה להתגבר אל תשכח השם איתך והוא תמיד עוזר גם אם יש צרה צרורה שכוח מהכל מהר להיות רק בשמחה לא צריך להתבייש רק לחשוב על מה שיש כל הזמן בכל מצב השם אותך יואב
רק שמחה ואהבה מורה עולם תמיד איתך והעולם כולו נברא רק לך רק בשבילך רק שמחה ואהבה בתוך הלב האמונה נשיר ביחד יש תקווה
Some joy into your heart. Come on and sing along. Join me in this Simche song. Happiness is all you need to lift your soul up to succeed. So come and join us now. 1, 2, 3, go!
Rak Simcha v'Ahava, Bore Olam tamid itcha, v'Haolam kulo nivra. Rak lecha, rak bishvilcha. Rak Simcha v'Ahava, v'toch halev ha'emuna. Nashir biyachad yesh tikva mikol.
Thank you. Friday evening, November 7th, 2003. Mommy, Enya Benyamin, from 9 months pregnant with Yaakov, when Daddy gave the strangest divine Torah at the Shabbos table. He said that anyone born on Shabbos would have superpowers beyond their wildest dreams. That night, Mommy went into labor and had a boy. Born on Shabbos. To Mommy, that meant only one thing. No pictures. No pictures of the baby who was just born with the cutest portion chin. No pictures of the birth that took place in a tent put up in the backyard. But don't worry, she made up for it. Even though Yaakov was number 7, Mommy took more pictures of him than any other child. Perhaps she was waiting to see when those superpowers would be exhibited. One thing was for sure, Yaakov was certainly not like the rest of us. He broke his arm for the first time when he was just 1.5, and that was just the beginning of his story. He went out to break his arm 3 times, his legs 4 times, he got stitches 4 times, broke his nose, and even chipped a tooth. Wow, it's a wonder they didn't report Mommy to child services. Could it be that Yaakov, who rode a two-wheeler at 3 and skied blues and greens at 5, was really just a klutz? After walking into the ping pong table and the kitchen cabinet door, we realized that he was in fact just a klutz. Of course, later Mommy realized that he just needed glasses. Yaakov got away with a lot of things his older sister would never even dream of. He basically got away with everything. He never had to have early bedtime. Mommy always did homework with him. He went on more vacations to Israel and Florida than any of us. He got to order all types of Rubik's Cubes. He got a bird. He got to do hockey, tennis, and basketball. He got a guitar and drums, a drone, and even an iPad. Wait a minute here. What's with this kid who basically got away with everything and the rest of us trying to fit together with our parents? Maybe it's those superpowers that he was talking about. Yaakov grew up in Maaretz with his 3 sisters and 3 brothers. Aliza, the oldest, was his second mother, along with Malachi, who used to stay with him in bed until he fell asleep. Binyamin, his oldest brother, taught him how to be a superhero. And Ariel, aside from being a fantastic narrator, also reminds Yaakov to stay awesome. Atara, his favorite sister, always takes him out for Slurpees, David Buster's, and tutors him in math. Basically, the coolest big sister ever. Hey, there are some advantages to making this video. And then, last but not least, there is Yon, Yaakov's partner in crime. Speaking about that, did we mention that Yaakov is a fantastic uncle?
Very high. I said that first. It's good.
Whoa! Whoa!
there to support him, thick and thin, his parents and grandparents.
לכל חי רצון, בוא תאחד ידיך ומצביע. Open up your head.